Thank you, Dr. Joe. Our next speaker is Renee Dufault. Renee will speak on the medicine of food, a primary relation. Renee served in the Navy as an industrial hygiene officer and in the public health service as an environmental health officer. During her PHS career, she worked at the National Institutes of Health, Environmental Protection Agency, Shoshone Paiute Tribes, and the Food and Drug Administration. There, she provided expertise in the areas of toxicology, environmental health, and industrial hygiene. In 2008, she retired early from federal service after 20 years to publish her findings of mercury in high fructose corn syrup and to continue her research with collaborators on the role of toxic food ingredients, what the role they play in the development of disease conditions. Her most popular article published in the Clinical Epigenetics Journal explores the gene-environment interactions responsible for the autism epidemic in the United States. She was a distinguished keynote speaker at the 2013 Clinical Epigenetics meeting in Germany. Dufault now serves as the executive director of the Food Ingredient and Health Research Institute and works as an adjunct professor at the United Tribes Technical College in Bismarck, North Dakota. Renee.
Thank you very much. Let's see, where's the little... Oops. Okay, good. Okay. Thank you very much for providing this educational opportunity. It's been a pleasure to participate in the workshops this week with Gudgy and Jose and the rest of the scientists. It's been a wonderful learning experience for me, and I'm very grateful. My colleagues and I at the Food Ingredient and Health Research Institute are grateful for your interest. We are a tax-exempt 501c3 nonprofit organization, and we have no paid employees. Our work thus far has been done on a volunteer basis. It's an honor to be here today to talk about food and medicine. Whoops. All right. Our mission at the Food Ingredient and Health Research Institute is to promote and support research and education on food ingredient safety for the purpose of disease prevention. We work primarily with underserved populations who are disproportionately impacted by disease prevalence. Today we're going to talk about food first, and we're going to start at the beginning. What did food look like at the beginning? In the past, before colonization, food was wholesome. It was not refined into products you could buy in a package. It was not genetically modified to resist pesticides, so farmers could spray their crops with toxins that would kill all living things. Corn, for example, was known by the people as maize, which in translation means that which sustains life. Corn was grown with reverence for its life-giving properties. Back in those days, food processing was simple. Corn cobs were braided together to form a string that was hung out to dry for storage and later use. What does food processing look like today? Today, corn is harvested and sent to the corn refiners, where it is made into various products known as corn sweeteners. In the corn sweetener product line, you begin with corn starch and end with high fructose corn syrup. To make 1 ton of high fructose corn syrup from corn starch, you need to follow this recipe. Hydrochloric acid and sodium hydroxide are chloralkali products, which are essentially made at a chlorine manufacturing company. And these two chemicals are used in the manufacturing process of high fructose corn syrup and all those products in the corn syrup line. What is not in this recipe is the trade secret. Maldonado and Lopez reported in a manufacturing journal, the cornstarch must be treated purposely with mercuric chloride, which is a mercury compound, an inorganic mercury compound, as part of the manufacturing process to prevent microorganisms from producing starch-degrading enzymes. Inorganic mercury is effective at killing the single-celled organisms that produce the enzymes that would otherwise degrade the cornstarch. Corn sweetener products are made from cornstarch and include the following sweeteners: high fructose corn syrup, modified corn starch, dextrose, maltodextrin, and fructose. U.S. per capita consumption of corn sweetener is significant compared to other food commodities. In 2010, the average American consumed 36.5 pounds per year of high fructose corn syrup. Well, corn sweetener, but most of that was high fructose corn syrup. Meanwhile, they consumed less than a pound a year of fresh spinach and only 2 pounds a year of canned tuna. They ate, on average, 36 pounds a year of vegetable oils or fat, which is not healthy. They also consume 93.3 pounds of wheat with a greater than 50% chance of exposure to pesticide residue. With colonization of the food supply came changes in sugar consumption. As you can see here, consumption of high fructose corn syrup has increased 9,467% since 1970. While cane and sugar beet consumption increased by 35%. So it's the kind of sugar that has changed. Corn sweeteners have invaded the food supply in the United States with colonization. Here we see some examples of products that may possibly contain corn sweeteners. Food ingredient labels tell us which products have corn sweeteners in them. We must read those food ingredient labels to avoid them. This chart was produced by the United States Department of Agriculture. It shows the per capita consumption of high fructose corn syrup in pounds since the 1960s. In 2005, Americans were consuming between 50 and 60 pounds per year per person of high fructose corn syrup. With all of this corn sweetener consumption, we've seen a rise in the rates of nutrition-related diseases. Is there any correlation between the consumption of high fructose corn syrup and autism? We published a study in 2009 in the Behavioral and Brain Functions Journal in which we compared the autism rates in California with the U.S. per capita consumption of high fructose corn syrup. Here in this table, we see the rates of diagnosed autism spectrum disorder for California, the only state that reports the number of cases of autism going back to the mid-1980s. The annual net growth in autism ranges from 9 to 11.8% between 1987 and 2006-2007. This net growth is consistent with the growth found in other states. Our data here shows that the annual growth rates of autism in California peaked in 2001 and 2002, and then declined in 2006. The peak years of consumption of high fructose corn syrup in the U.S. occurred at the same time between 2000 and 2002 at 44.6 and 44.8 pounds per year of syrup. The problem with all of this corn syrup consumption is corn sweeteners are often contaminated with inorganic mercury. In samples of high fructose corn syrup collected directly from manufacturers and analyzed for mercury, we found mercury concentrations ranging from below a detection limit of 0.005 to 0.57 micrograms mercury per gram of high fructose corn syrup. Canadian researchers led by Karen Rideout duplicated our findings in 2010. And those samples that they analyzed were collected in that time frame, 2010. How did the mercury get into the high fructose corn syrup? Two possible ways. In the first way, mercuric chloride is intentionally added to the cornstarch at the beginning of the process, manufacturing process. In the second way, corn syrup manufacturers use chemicals made from mercury cell chloralkali process. These mercury cell chemicals always have mercury residue in them, so whatever you make using these chemicals can then contain mercury residue. So sodium hydroxide made from mercury cell is always going to have trace levels of mercury. And that sodium hydroxide, that is what many sodium chemicals are made of. So all those sodium chemicals that are in the food supply could have mercury residue. In 2005, the largest user of the mercury cell chloralkali chemicals was the high fructose corn syrup manufacturers. Mercury cell chloralkali chemical products are used extensively in food processing and always contain the mercury residue. They're used to manufacture sodium chemicals, food colors, and in the food processing. For example, the mercury cell chlorine used to bleach flour is expected to contain a small amount of mercury residue. There is an international food safety standard that states how much mercury is allowed in the chlorine used to bleach flour. Mercury is great for enhancing product shelf life. It kills the mold in bread, doesn't allow it to begin to grow. You ever wonder why that white bread stays so good forever? What is all this mercury doing to us and to our children? Mercury exposure is associated with the development of type 2 diabetes. In a recently published article, researchers led by Dr. He reported finding mercury exposures are significantly and independently associated with the development of diabetes. They looked at longitudinal data collected from a prospective cohort of 3,875 American young adults between the ages of 20 and 32 years that were free of diabetes in 1987. They followed these individuals over 18 years until 2005. They used multivariate analysis and adjusted for age, sex, ethnicity, education, smoking status, alcohol consumption, physical activity, family history of diabetes, selenium, dietary intake of omega-3 fatty acids, and magnesium, and found the elevated risk of diabetes associated with mercury exposure. That was a good study because they looked at all the different factors that are known to be associated when either positively or negatively with diabetes. What kind of mercury exposure? Here's a picture of the mercury cycle. Is it the mercury we breathe in from the coal-fired power plant emissions? Is it the organic mercury from the contaminated fish we might eat? Or is it the inorganic mercury in our food supply? To get a handle on type 2 diabetes, we need to look at the genes involved in glucose homeostasis, what keeps our glucose in balance. The GLUT4 gene plays a major role in regulating whole body glucose homeostasis, and its expression has been found to be inversely associated with insulin resistance in obese diabetics. This means GLUT4 activity is reduced in conditions of insulin resistance. Inorganic mercury has been found to significantly reduce GLUT4 gene activity. altering glucose metabolism in fat cells. Mercury exposure causes a modest increase in glucose transport and may contribute to the development of insulin resistance by elevating glucose levels compared to insulin. It is clear that inorganic mercury exposure may be a significant factor in the development of type 2 diabetes. Where do we get the majority of our inorganic mercury exposure from? Processed food containing corn sweeteners, sodium chemicals, food colors, and bleached flour are all potential sources of inorganic mercury exposure. How do we know we are exposed to inorganic mercury when we consume processed food? We tested the hypothesis that inorganic mercury exposure comes from processed food. We administered two different interventions at the Fort Peck Community College over 10 weeks in Montana. In one intervention, we delivered an online nutrition intervention course. We tracked the dietary changes made by the students who completed the course. In another intervention, students participated in a support group to eliminate corn sweeteners from their diet. We determined the changes in student health status after administering both of the 10-week interventions. The data in the table shows a significant difference between the pre- and post-intervention periods with respect to participant weight, body mass index, or BMI, and fasting glucose measurements. Overall, students saw significant drops in their weight, BMI, and fasting glucose. The analysis of the data implies that while there is not statistically significant difference between the pre and post measurements on HOMA, the homeostasis model for insulin resistance, the trend is downward and participants were heading in the right direction with the dietary changes. The students in the online nutrition intervention course significantly reduced their intake of all processed foods, and they had lower inorganic mercury levels at the end of the 10-week intervention period compared to the students who only eliminated corn sweeteners from their diet. So we know that the mercury in the foods is not just in the corn sweeteners. It's in the other chemicals as well. We had one student out of 10 involved in the intervention who dropped out of the corn sweetener elimination group because she found it very difficult to give up the fructose. It was addictive. And she was unable to make any dietary change at all. This student had the highest inorganic mercury level of all. The students who participated, did I do that one already? I think I do. I did that one. There we go. Yeah. The students who participated in the corn sweetener elimination support group had more significant changes in their BMI and their weight compared to the students who participated in the online nutrition intervention course. It appeared that corn sweetener consumption contributed greatly to weight gain and obesity. The students who participated in the online intervention course who had significantly reduced their intake of all processed foods had a statistically significant drop in their fasting glucose levels and lower inorganic mercury levels. Both groups had reductions in their fasting glucose. It appeared, though, that there was a connection between processed food intake, inorganic blood mercury, and fasting glucose. We needed to look at a larger data set because we only had a few students. So we examined data collected by CDC's National Health and Nutrition Examination Survey, also known as NHANES. This is the gold standard, NHANES data. We looked at the fasting glucose and the inorganic mercury levels of 16,232 Americans and found a direct association between inorganic mercury and fasting glucose levels. The higher the inorganic mercury, the higher the glucose levels. We also looked at organic mercury and fasting glucose. The organic mercury would be the mercury you get from fish consumption. But there was no relationship at all between organic mercury and fasting glucose. So it appears that it's the inorganic mercury we are taking into our bodies from the consumption of processed foods that may be reducing our GLUT4 gene activity, as would be expected, and causing a disruption in our metabolism by altering the glucose homeostasis. When toxic substances like inorganic mercury turn genes on or turn genes off, these interactions occur outside of the gene. The study of these interactions is called epigenetics. Epi meaning outside the gene. The process I just took you through demonstrates how we can take the macro epigenetic approach in considering in conducting medical research. Macro epigenetics is defined as the process of examining food supplies and their impact on body metabolism and gene function, along with what is known about environmental exposures across populations. My collaborators at the Food Ingredient Health Research Institute use this same approach to identify and publish the peer-reviewed article in the Clinical Epigenetics Journal that explains some of the factors responsible for the autism epidemic in the United States. Our most recent clinical trial at the Fort Peck Community College helped us find the connection between inorganic mercury and fasting glucose levels. The study was community-based and involved the active participation of the students and their families living in the Fort Peck Indian community. This is the macroepigenetic model that was created from our research experience. It explains the role of inorganic mercury in glucose homeostasis in type 2 diabetes. This is an evidence-based model that is backed by peer-reviewed journal articles and references. It is clear that processed food consumption leading to inorganic mercury exposure or environmental mercury exposure in and of itself is a factor in the development of type 2 diabetes. So right here, there's been a study already done by human beings living near a contaminated chloralkali manufacturing plant. So there was mercury all over their environment. And these humans developed insulin resistance. So there's a study connecting that. So then we also know that humans that develop insulin resistance go on often, unless there's not an intervention, to develop type 2 diabetes. And we know that if you have two type 2 diabetic parents in the human population, you end up with offspring who are insulin resistant. So you have that transgenerational impact of what is passed down through the genes. So we also know that mercury cell chloralkali chemicals are used in processed foods, or in processing foods are added to foods as preservatives. And we know that corn sweetener consumption leads to obesity, which then further increases your risk of type 2 diabetes. We know that when you feed rats high fructose corn syrup, that their PON1 gene activity is reduced, and that PON1 gene needs to express itself in order to for the body to produce an enzyme called peroxidase, which you've got to have to be able to metabolize that the organophosphate pesticides found in that wheat that you're consuming every 95 pounds of wheat every year. So you've got to have that gene expression. And we know that type 2 diabetics that are obese have reduced POM1 gene activity. See, that study's been done. And with the elevated mercury in the blood of the humans eating the processed foods, you get the oxidative stress, with the high fructose corn syrup or mercury exposure, either way, both. Reductions in GLUT4 gene activity, elevated fasting glucose levels, type 2 diabetes. So food ingredient safety is an issue because type 2 diabetes is increasing across the globe. So who's in charge of food ingredient safety? Well, most people think the Food and Drug Administration, or the FDA, is in charge of food ingredient safety. But in reality, food ingredient safety at the international level is now regulated by the U.S. Pharmacopoeial Convention. The U.S. Pharmacopoeial Convention, or USP, is a scientific nonprofit organization that sets standards for the identity, strength, quality, and purity of medicines and food ingredients and dietary supplements manufactured, distributed, and consumed worldwide. USP standards are enforceable in the United States by the Food and Drug Administration. And these standards are used in more than 140 countries. You might want to know that this trade organization was established in 1820, many years before the FDA even came into being. So now we're on the topic of medicine. Hopefully it is clear that if we as humans consume processed foods, we will need medicine regulated by the U.S. Pharmacopoeial Convention. Toxic substances in our environment, including the food ingredients in the food we eat, make us more susceptible to disease. Today, we've only touched upon one toxic substance in the food supply, and that's inorganic mercury. What can we do to prevent disease and heal ourselves? We can eat whole organic foods whenever possible to reduce our inorganic mercury exposure. We can start and maintain sustainable and dynamic community gardens so they will feed the entire village, just as we did before colonization, industrialization, and globalization. We must invest in the education of our people so they know what to eat in order to stay healthy. We must stay away from processed foods. Real food that you grow yourself is the medicine we need to prevent disease. We must reclaim our traditional food supplies. Thank you for your attention.